Come on, man. And with the local DBC news, Ellen Cooje with a triumphant comeback. For a solo. But tonight,
don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. I'm rocking my penis. Put suckers in fear. Making the tears rain down like a monsoon. Listen to the bass go boom. Explosions.
Welcome to Freedom Lovin'. This is Kevin, and this is episode number 52. And don't call it a comeback. In just a minute, I'm going to chat about the monumental difference between earning $1 online and nothing at all. So, yeah, I took a little bit of a break. The last podcast was about 5 or 6 weeks ago, so I've been focusing on my online businesses. I wanted to try to make a little more money, and I was successfully able to do that. I focused mostly on Facebook ads. And that was really good. That was a really good thing. I learned a lot of stuff. I took a couple courses and applied everything I learned, and things went well. Although it wasn't completely easy and simple, there was a little bit of up and down with that. I think I had really good success for a couple weeks, and then it kind of tailed off, and then I figured some things out and got it back going. But it's definitely a lot of work to do, but definitely it has paid off, and just a few things. Thanks. Really appreciate all your messages. I've gotten emails from a few people, and it was really great to hear some of the comments, people asking what happened to the podcast. And I've gotten a couple conversations with people that we talked about what they're doing, what they're up to, building freedom and kind of breaking out of the 9-to-5 and doing their own thing. So that's been awesome. And some of the comments. So we have a few new reviews. There's 3 new reviews on iTunes, and I will read those off. So the first one is Simply the Best, 5 stars, by Percy Dovtonsel. Dovtonsel, I hope I said that right. Many podcasts cover location independence and entrepreneurism, but none is quite as energizing as this one, in my opinion. Kevin will make you want to take the leap. Great interviews that are always topical and filled with useful info. Thanks, Percy. Appreciate that, and I'll try to keep that good content going for sure. The second one is Listening While I Work and Plan My Digital Nomad Beginning, 5 stars, by Elissa. I think it's Elissa, who I've exchanged some emails with, who's working on some interesting projects, and definitely want to keep hearing about what she's up to. And she says, really enjoying going through the archives. My favorite points are when you talk about your personal life and your travels. I feel this gives the listener a real insider's take. From a business standpoint, my favorite topics are when you go step by step on how to get mobile from building a website to picking a location. If you could cover more subscription-based businesses, in particular, I'd love to hear from a subscription business that offers a product, as I cannot find a podcast about this. That would be so helpful. Thank you. Well, thanks, Alyssa, for your comment. And yeah, that sounds like a great plan. I have a subscription business. It's not actually a product. It's a digital product. And that's at 100mustreads.com. And that's business book summaries. And we have PDFs and audios. And so we have a monthly plan. You can pay all at once for the year. And there's a free plan as well. So that's something that's in the works. I've been working on that for a couple of years, but we're changing everything up. And so I will keep you posted on that, but I will look for also anyone that's in that niche or that area of building membership websites and has a product. So great idea. And the last one is Great, 5 stars, by Matt Maravich. Outstanding show. Great listen. Kevin is an outstanding podcaster. Thanks, Matt, and I'm really curious if you are the same Matt Maravich that I worked with way back in my corporate days. So I think this was back like as early as 2000 when I was working at a company there in the Bay Area, and there was a guy named Matt Maravich in my company. So if that is you, I'd love to hear from you, and that's really cool that you're breaking out and doing some things on your own as well, or at least heading that direction. So shoot me an email, kevin@freedomlovin.com, and anyone else, if you have anything to say, if you want to chat with me, shoot me an email, or I would love it if you could give us a review on iTunes, and you just open up your iTunes and go in there and give a rating and review. That would be much appreciated, and I will read yours on the next show. So I'm back in San Diego, just to give a little wrap-up on the last few weeks. So I spent August in Austin, and the main goal for me was to sell my rental house, and that turned into a complete nightmare. Just a whole lot of things went wrong. In the end, it's done, it's sold. I walked away having to pay in money, and I thought I was going to make a few measly $1,000, but it didn't even work out. So I don't even want to get into the details. It's something that I do not want to go through again. It was like every day there was a new round of paperwork that I had to come up with and sign and get, you know, into escrow right away. And so, but we were supposed to close at the end of the month, and I was supposed to close on August 28th, and we ended up closing on, I think, the 4th of September. It was a crazy ending. It was like every day my lender was delaying the closing each day for no reason. They were just like, oh, we haven't got the documents yet. And it's like they had a whole month to get they had all the documents like weeks ago, and they just were sitting on them. So I learned some things this time around for sure. Never deal with banks if you can avoid it. I mean, banks are just awful. They're really, really awful. And I just don't recommend working with lenders. I never want to buy a house. I never want to buy a house again. I don't want to own a house. I don't want to live in an own house. I'm happy to rent and not have to deal with all that. So that is one lesson that I will take away from that. And then also, if you are buying a house, or if you're renting a house even, I would highly recommend to really investigate the homeowners association before you move into a neighborhood. The place that I owned, it was outside of Austin, and this homeowners association was just vicious, and they were always out to nickel and dime me. They were constantly trying to impose fees on me, and I fought a lot of them. And actually, what happens is you fight them and then you negotiate with them. So even if you're totally innocent on whatever they're trying to charge you with, like your grass wasn't, you know, cut to the level that they wanted it to. Even if you're totally innocent on that, they still make you pay. It's kind of like a government with taxes. Like, you can't get out of it. There's no way. And so what happened was I got a lien put on one of my houses, and I wasn't even aware of this because I had switched my house into an LLC instead of having it under my name, and I didn't notify the HOA. So they were sending certified letters to an address that is not where I get mail, and I had no idea this was happening. So I found out at closing that they got a little fee on me. So they had a lien on me. I had to pay that off. I tried to fight it. I haven't been able to fight it. I don't know. I may just let the whole thing go at this point. Even though it's kind of a little bit of money, I just don't think I can really win. But these people are really bad. And most HOAs I don't think are great, but there's definitely different degrees of how bad they can be. So anyway, that's the short story of that. And then I took off. I signed the papers, got rid of the house, and got out of there. I packed my car the night before, and I drove out of Austin, and took a couple stops on the way back instead of going all the way through, because my body just can't handle the straight-through driving for very long. So I stopped in Fort Stockton, Texas, which has nothing. It doesn't even really have many restaurants. Had some fast food, and then the next day I drove to Tucson, and I stayed in this really awesome hotel called the Comfort Suites. And I know the Comfort Suites aren't typically like totally cool places, but that one is in particular, this one in Tucson, it was really nice and it was really cheap. And it's right by the Sabino Canyon, which is a nice little hiking area. So the next day I went in the morning and I went for a little hike, and then I went on this tram that goes supposed to go to the top of the mountain, but the bridges were flooded. So it was like, because there was monsoon season and they were getting a ton of rain. So, which is really cool. And so there's no drought in Arizona. I don't think there is a drought, but there's plenty of water. And so I went up with a bunch of old people. We took this tram. They took us to a couple different stops going up this mountain. And it was cool. I got a couple good pictures, and I really love the desert scenery. I don't think I could ever live in the desert, but I definitely appreciate the scenery, and just it's cool out there. Tucson's a really, it's a really neat little town. I don't think I would live there. I think I thought about it at one point, because the rent there is so cheap. I mean, one bedroom's pretty decent. One bedroom's for $600 a month. It's really not bad, and it's not a horrible place. It's like the weather isn't terrible. It's definitely a little toasty in the summer, but it's not even really as bad as it's not as bad as Phoenix. I know it's a little cooler than that, so it's really not bad. And I think the winter, you know, they do get snow once in a while or something, but otherwise, I thought about staying there, and I thought, well, maybe I'll just get my apartment here and just stay here for a while. But then my better senses took over, and I drove back to San Diego. So I got here, and I got temporarily, I decided to not make my life stressful, so I got an Airbnb place for 7 days so that I can kind of sort out and look at apartments and figure out where I'm going to stay for a while. And this place is, it's in Bankers Hill, which is a really cool neighborhood. And it's got some really cool houses and apartments and things, but it's right in the flight path. So it's right near the airport. And so you got to deal with airplanes going overhead. But this place has, and I think most of the places around here have, double pane windows. So the noise is not as bad as it could be. It's still obvious, still really obvious when a plane is going over. But you don't have to, it's not, like it hasn't woken me up yet. And they pretty much stop like around 11, sometimes 11:30 is about the latest I've heard a plane. And then they don't really start landing until about 7:30, something like that. So it's not horrible, but I still think it's I don't think I'd want to, I know you get used to the air, the plane noise, but I don't think I'd want to get used to that. I think I'd rather just live in somewhere that's a little quieter. So anyway, I'm about to sign a lease, and it's going to be for about 8.5 months. So it's going to put me through to end of May next year, which doesn't necessarily mean that I am just in San Diego for the next 8.5 months. It's a really nice location. It's a really nice place, and it's furnished. The plan is that I'm going to rent it out on Airbnb as I leave town. So I already am planning to go down to Columbia for like a week in November. So that's the first time I'm going to try to Airbnb it and see what happens. But I think I can get part of my rent back by doing that. So that's kind of nice. Assuming that everything is cool with my landlord and they are not going to scrutinize too much, because they seem cool. I mean, the people that I met, the property manager and everything, they seemed really nice, and they were able to get me the place, which is sometimes not that easy being a self-employed entrepreneur. You have to prove a lot of things, and they were good about it, though. I've had much worse experiences trying to prove everything, you know, every last little thing where they're asking for like super detailed stuff. And this one was like, okay, just show us, you know, bank statements, and they were, you know, they were nice about it. So anyway, I'm moving in there next week and looking forward to that. Yeah, but I mean, I learned some things about apartments here in the last month. One is really investigate before you move into a place. In Austin, my last month, I took this place kind of last minute. I needed a place just for August, and I was like, I found this one on Craigslist, and this girl was leaving the country for 6 weeks. So I thought it was perfect, because I thought I'd needed it for about 5 weeks. So, and she was really nice, and we just did a cash deal and didn't do any paperwork or anything. So the problem started like the second night I was there. I saw a cockroach on the floor, and these were the big cockroaches. And if you listen to the podcast, I've had cockroach issues in the past, but these, usually it's been the German roaches, which are still really annoying, but they're at least not that big. These are the big American roaches. They're like maybe an inch and a half long, and they have wings, and they're just ugly and nasty, and it's like the worst thing in life. So I saw that, and I was like, okay, I got to move out because I'm not dealing with cockroaches. And I called her because she was still in town, and she's like, no, I've already spent the money on rent, so I don't have the money. And so that was not an issue. That was not a possibility. I thought about even paying double rent, just going somewhere else. But then I thought, okay, she said she would take care of it. The pest control people were coming out the next day. I'm like, okay, I'll just deal with this, because I didn't want to pay double rent. So anyway, the roach lady came out and sprayed, and I talked to her a little bit, and I felt like pretty good about the odds of the roaches being gone. But yeah, the next few days definitely saw some more roaches, and then eventually I stopped seeing roaches, and I started feeling a little bit better about everything. And I think there was about a 10-day period where I didn't see one bug, and I was like, okay, so I think they're gone. And then things started getting, let's see, then I think I saw one, you know, maybe my last week there. And I was like, okay, well, I only have one more week. So then the air conditioner went out. So there was they had these two wall air conditioners. One of them was really old. And when I heard it the first time, I'm like, that thing has got to be 50 years old and is ready to die. So, and it did. So it died. And then I had this one little wall air conditioner, which helped, but it was still really hot. And luckily, it was right around that time it started to cool down a little bit, from like 100 degrees to 94 Fahrenheit, and which actually does make a big difference. And so it was tolerable, but then it started getting hot again, like in the next few days. And so then it was starting to get really ridiculous, and I couldn't get anyone to come out to fix it. So it was like, then I saw I saw another roach. And then I was freaked out about roaches in my bed, and I just couldn't think about anything else. when I was sleeping. So one night, it was like maybe August 29th, towards the end of the month, I got up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom, came back, there was a roach on my bed. And just as I, my worst nightmare was coming true, and I went to kill it, and it flew away, it flew into the wall, then it landed on the carpet and started running, and I tried to get it, or I couldn't see it, I lost it for a second, I was like, oh no, and then I saw it, and I tried to kill it, and it was like, it wouldn't die, and I was trying to hit it with a paper, and it just wouldn't die, and I finally got it. And so that was kind of the end of my rope. So I stayed one more night in that place, and I slept on the couch. And then I got out of there, and I went to hotels. So I had hotels the last couple nights there in Austin, which was a good choice because I slept much better. And so, yeah, lesson learned. I mean, you really have to investigate places before moving in, and I really didn't. I thought, yeah, this place is fine. Like, she seems nice, and everything seems okay, but there, it definitely wasn't. And I think she actually just put up with the roaches, which is hilarious because, you know, you picture like kind of college students, like guys, you know, sitting there going, oh, who cares? It's just roaches. But this is like a, I don't know, 20-something-year-old woman, and it seemed like she was clean and everything, but you just never know. So that was the thing with that. And I think it pays to pay a little bit more sometimes. So I was really, I thought I was getting a really good, you know, really good deal. It was in a good part of town. It was in just south of downtown. And so you could walk to a lot of things. And, you know, there was a lot of good things about it. But just, yeah, that didn't work out too well. So I was happy to get out and just head back to San Diego. And now I've been here for a few days. And the weather has been great. It's been like mid-80s, which for everybody here, they think it's like ridiculously hot. But I like it. It has been a little bit humid. So that's kind of, that'll be nice when that kind of dies down, which should be in a few days. But it's nice. I mean, it's been sunny. The sunsets have been amazing, and I'm enjoying reconnecting with people here. Kind of missing some things about Austin. I had a good group of entrepreneurs there that we did a lot of things together, and we were really connected. Like, we had a GroupMe app where we could see, you know, you could put in there what you're doing, and everyone can see, and we'd chat back and forth, and we'd get together for lunches and dinners and drinks, and we had a Sunday brunch every Sunday, and it was cool because we could meet, get together, talk about business, and we could talk about a lot of things, you know, a lot of different variety of topics. And everybody in the group I really liked. I really had a great experience, and I felt like at home with those people. So that's something that I want to bring, like that type of thing is something I want to bring to San Diego. So I am trying to put together a similar kind of group, although it'll be hard to do because I think that group was for specific reasons. That group, partly it's because it's Austin, and partly because we have our Dynamite Circle group that kind of bled into that. And so there's a lot of things that went into that, but I'm going to try to create something like that where I can be connected to a lot of entrepreneurs here or solo entrepreneurs, and we can have get-togethers and, you know, and ask each other questions and give advice and that kind of thing. I think that's just an awesome thing to have, especially when you're a solo entrepreneur, which sometimes can mean a lot of down alone time. So, or at least, you know, time on your computer. So it's good to get away and do different things and talk to different people, get different perspectives. So that's that. So that's what I'm working on. That's one of the things I'm working on here in San Diego. And I wrote a blog post a couple weeks ago, and it's called "The Monumental Difference Between Earning $1 Online and Nothing." So what inspired this was I was taking a couple of courses on Facebook ads, and I felt like they were going into too much detail almost. Like, it was just overkill. Like, they want to fill so much into one course that they overdo it. And they also have this thing where it's like, you need to do everything exactly perfect. And they don't really say that you can do it 80% right and you'll be getting it most of the benefit. So that's where I fall. I fall into I like the 80-20 approach, which is like 20% of the things you do are going to benefit you the most. So you focus on the things that will benefit you the most. And if it's earning money, if you're talking about earning money, then a lot of times it's not worth it to go into all this detail. It's worth it to start out doing the things that generally work and then detail down as you go. So that's been my philosophy, and I want to create a course around this. So I wrote this blog post, and it's called, and as I said, it's called "The Monumental Difference Between Earning $1 Online and Nothing." There are 10 billion courses out there on how to make money online. I know because I've counted all of them. If you spend much time at all in the world of internet marketing, you will start to get the feeling that almost everyone but you is making $20,000 a month or more. If you're not a millionaire online, you're doing it wrong. Actually, something must be wrong with you here are 8 people who are dumber than you and had less resources and are making 6 figures a month. A monkey could follow our course and pull off 10K a month. Here, look at this guy. He's just running a few ads and pulling in seven figures. And he smokes weed and surfs all day. What's your problem? Then try going to some of the networking events, seminars, or conferences. Everyone is doing something big. It seems like light years away if you are just starting out. It can feel overwhelming, frustrating, and annoying to hear 90 million, quote, success stories about online marketers when you haven't even made $1 yet. And many of the courses I have gone through emphasize this idea of making shit tons of money. As a newbie or beginner, or just someone who wants to start making some passive income, this is the reverse of what is intended to be motivational. So most people stay stuck, frozen, not able to even do the first thing to get them to the goal of online income. Part of this is the fear of success or fear of change. Doing things differently means going against what they are used to. And people hate change. And the industry, while it's good at capturing emotional, knee-jerk buyers, which is actually most humans, keeps people from moving from no income to earning $1 online. When you read all the hypey sales pages, you are made to believe that you can achieve what all these people, what all these other people have done, make tons of money without having any previous knowledge or skills, and by working, quote, 4 hours a week. Prospective online business people get excited. They invest in a course or multiple courses, and what happens is one of three things. One, they never even open up the product, watch the first video, or read the first page. They got their emotional need for feeling good about themselves fulfilled by pushing the buy button. A small part of them thinks that by clicking buy, they will magically be making $20,000 a month in a short time without doing anything. But they also know at some level that they won't do anything. And that's about 97% of people. Two, they start down the path, get to the first module or two, and get overwhelmed and quit. It's like they would prefer to make no money at all instead of falling short of the millions that the course seems to be setting them up to make. In other words, why try? I'll never get to $10 million anyway. I feel better giving up now. And this is about 2.5% of people. Three, they take the course seriously, implement everything, and start to see some money start coming in. Most of these people don't end up making millions, or even close. But some end up with a few dollars, maybe a few hundred dollars coming in every month. They are way ahead of where they were when they started. But they don't feel like, quote, enough, because, quote, everyone else is traveling the world or buying mansions or kicking it on some tropical beach. Insert proverbial image of sitting on a beach chair with laptop on lap, while bank accounts keep filling up. And this is about 0.5% of people. The problem with many online marketing courses is they overdeliver. That sounds like a good thing if you were a customer. But when you were in the course, it would appear that everything is a priority. For example, you must blog. You must test everything. You must have absolute rockstar sales copy. You have to be doing Twitter, making videos, running an affiliate program, doing SEO, AdWords, Facebook ads, webinars, and a ton of other crucial things, or you are just not going to make your site work. After reading Perry Marshall's 80-20 Sales and Marketing, I can see the holes in these courses much more clearly. For example, why would you want to spend 6 months blogging to get some traffic when you can learn a few pay-per-click skills and get traffic the next day or two? Or another popular thing for people who teach internet marketing to claim is, you must test the crap out of everything. It's all about testing. Or is it? What if you can start making sales the first day, then run a test against that and incrementally improve your profits, rather than start out testing 47 things, which could take you 2 weeks to even set up? It comes down to something called money momentum. If you don't have it, it can be hard to get. If you have it, you can make reasonable increases to your income. Maybe you made $50 your first month with your website. While $50 in a month may be horrible to someone making $10,000 a month, to compare yourself to the person doing $10,000 will be the death of your business. What if you made $100 the next month? Is a 100% increase in profits terrible? This incrementalism, 80-20, and money momentum is what is missing today in all the ways to get started in online marketing. I've come up with some ideas of a sample, straightforward, minimalist 80-20 course that I'm thinking of putting together. Here's the quick version of what I'm thinking. 5 steps to getting an online business up and running and earning your first $1 online. One is niche. Keywords, Amazon, what you see around you. Two is product. Creation, shipment, online course, or product. Three is website. WordPress with Designer from Odesk, or do it yourself with something like OptimizePress. Four is sales copy. Three, tips page, squeeze page, and sales letter page. Five is traffic, Facebook ads, quick and dirty, how-to course. So it would be a course on Facebook ads, so a course within the bigger course. This course would not be in-depth, but it will be step by minimalist step. I'm not going to teach how to build a website. That takes too long, and it's very annoying for non-technical people. I'm not going to teach mindset. There are a million places to get motivation. This is just getting people to $1. The money momentum will take care of a lot of the motivation from there. I'm not going to teach about the latest great plugins. There are only a handful that you need to get started. I am not going to get into SEO. It's slow and boring and can come later, after you've got some money momentum. I'm not going to scare anyone into thinking writing sales copy means you need years of experience or hiring a writer for $10,000. Plenty of ways to get this done quickly. I'm going to give everything I know about Facebook ads. I've taken several courses and had success making money in a small niche. This is where you will spend the most time. The idea here is to deliver everything someone needs to go from zero to $1 in earnings on their website. If someone can get to $1, they have a much higher chance of the $10K, $20K, or $100K a month. But zero to $10K is impossible without going from zero to $1 first. And this is a scaled-down minimalist course meant to get right to the heart, right to the meat and potatoes of what to do to earn a dollar as fast as possible. This is meant to get beginners unstuck. This course will cost in the range of $100. No monthly fees, no paying for things they don't need or won't use. What do you think? What would you add or cut out? What do you hate about courses you've taken to help you start building online income? What has worked? So that's the end of my blog post. And after getting some feedback on this post, people said, well, I don't want to just earn a dollar. So what about $100 instead? And that's probably more reasonable to go from zero to $100. But the point is that you can make $0 for years on end easily. But to make a dollar on something that you created is, or even an affiliate product is, you know, that's a huge difference. So just going from zero to $1 is not saying that you can only, you know, your first month is only going to be a dollar. It could be $100. It could be $200. But it's more likely that you will start with something that's not making any money for a little bit, and that's okay, because it can take some time. And just getting off, you know, out of the starting blocks is the goal at first. You know, to kind of make those incremental goals. So that's the idea I have. I really would love feedback from you if you have anything to add to this, to critique about it. I think that this is something I want to pursue, and in the minimalist 80/20 fashion, I don't want to spend a long time putting together the course. I think I can do it pretty quickly and get it out there, but I definitely want to hear what would be the most helpful for anyone out there that's working on kind of building a freedom business or creating something that is going to help them to break free and be able to do what they want. So that's pretty much it. And again, I'd love your comments, wherever you can get them to me, if it's email or Facebook or Twitter or iTunes, all good. And just a really quick, I don't want to even go over the comments, but I did a podcast a little while ago, and I had some words about Obamacare and how it was affecting me. And I got a long response on the post on freedomlovin.com about Obamacare and how I am being ignorant and how it's actually a really good thing. And I just didn't look into it enough. And I didn't respond to that comment because I just don't want to argue about political stuff, because it all goes back to emotions. And nobody is going to really listen when it comes to emotional topics. So I don't, you know, I definitely have opinions, but I don't like to get into political debates on this show, because it's just a waste of time at this point. And I'm just relaying what happened to me with Obamacare. I'm not like trying to make any claims, but it definitely was not beneficial to me. And I did look into all the different ways that I could do healthcare. And Obamacare has added money to what I was paying, and I'm getting worse coverage. So that's my situation, and perhaps other people have different situations. I'm happy to hear from you if you are loving Obamacare and you're getting something out of it. But every business person that I've talked to, I think just about every business person that I've talked to about it, does not like it, it has not been beneficial, and it's actually been a net negative for their costs and the quality of healthcare. But I am getting more interested in how to solve that problem without trying to work the political route or to just sit and complain about it. So I think there are solutions out there, and so we can overcome this. It's not the end of the world, and that's the point. I mean, it's unfortunate that we have the political system that we do that causes these kind of things, but that's just the way it is right now, and I'm not here to fight that battle, and I'm certainly not going to play politics because that's a losing battle, and I will never have one iota of influence if that's the route that I go. But if I stick with entrepreneurial ventures and entrepreneurism, and I support entrepreneurs, I think I will have influence. And so that's the angle that I'm choosing to go. So anyway, if you want to look that up, it's just look at Freedom Lovin' and look for the podcast on Obamacare. I can't remember what number it is, but you can see that, and you can see the post, and you can chime in if you feel like it, or send me a comment if you want. That would be that'd be awesome. So anyway, I will wrap this up, and I hope you are doing well out there. I can't wait to continue this show. We're going to have some really awesome guests coming up, and I'm going to try to make it 2 to 3 times a month if I can, and we will keep working this and keep working on being as free as we possibly can in our lives. And I hope you have a great week. Go out there and build some freedom, and we'll talk to you soon. But now I got a new tour. I'm going insane. Starting a hurricane for listen pain. Letting you know you can't gain or maintain unless you see my name. Ripping, killing, digging and drilling a hole. Past the old goal.
Get upstairs and take out that garbage.